Okay, so what did you guys figure out? Why is grammar like the toilet? So guys, here are the extra packets if you need them, okay? I like this crystal laser, but lots of people use it every day, but they don't know how it works, right? That's fine, right? It's fine that we use grammar but don't know how it works. The issue that comes up is when stuff doesn't work and we don't know how to fix it. You ever had that moment? No, when something about the toilet you are using or just used went wrong, and you're like, I don't know how to fix this. I need somebody to help me fix this. That's like the most ugly, messy, and embarrassing thing in life, right? Have you guys seen, what's the movie, Along Came Polly or whatever? Oh, please God, fix the toilet, I'll save 1,000 starving orphans or whatever, and you like tries to, she like shoves a towel in there and it gets worse. Okay, so, grammar is like a toilet because we use it every day. I really hope they don't do that all for you. We use it every day, but we often don't know exactly how every little piece works. It'd be easier, life would be easier, college will be easier, high school will be easier if we understand it a little bit better, and you'll get a better score on the SAT writing and language section if you have just a few tidbits of knowledge on how grammar works. I'm going to go really fast through this slideshow because I want to have some time to do the practice stuff. So it's the second section of the SAT. 44 questions, you have 35 minutes, that means you have a minute and 15 seconds per question. That's actually a lot when you think back to the, I don't know if I did the math right on that, I'm going to think of that. Somebody do the math on that, 44 divided by 35. That sounds wrong to me.
We'll check it.
Okay, so 44 divided by 35.
Or no,
35 divided by 44, right?
What? You're actually off.
Like, how off am I?
You get more per question.
Okay.
1.26.
Well, but 0.26 times 60 is 50. Oh, sorry, I'm right. So, all that to say that you have about the same amount of time per question on the writing as you did on the reading, but you are not going to feel as rushed with this one, at least in my opinion. Okay? So, there's four passages. It's about 1,000 fewer words. There's one related to a career topic. There's one related to the humanities. There's one related to social studies, and one related to science. There's 11 questions per passage, and you are going to notice that some of them are harder and some of them are easier questions. They're looking for development, organization, and language use. So you're going to see these things come up as we go through the practice test we're going to do today. You will have access to this presentation online, so don't worry about paying too close attention to this stuff. And then there's the whole convention stuff, the rules, okay? That's the big one. Punctuation, word choice, semicolon, oh, that is punctuation. Okay, we'll see that as we go through the practice. So conventions relate to these big three ideas. Sentence structure, okay, how you join parts of sentences together, how do you keep them parallel, and then how do you make sure that you don't have dangling modifiers or misplaced modifiers. Usage, are you using the correct words, do things actually make sense, and then punctuation like I just discussed. So you can check that list out later. So today what I want to do is I want to go through this packet with you, and if you remember from the reading test prep about 2 weeks ago, we tried to do it without actually reading the passages, right? I want you to try to do that with me today as we do this practice, okay? There are gonna be some questions we're not gonna be able to answer. So what's that gonna mean? We're gonna circle those and come back to them, all right? If we have time, or just guess.
Slap a guess on them.
But we prefer if we have time to come back and check them. Okay, so let's switch over. If you guys open up your test packets, we're gonna go through it together. Now. I'm gonna, if we don't arrive at the correct answer and a couple of guesses, I'm just gonna give you the answer, because the most important part, it's not actually getting the correct answer on the practice, it's understanding why is that the correct answer. Okay, so, without reading the passage, because there are lots of these you can get correct without actually reading the passage. So, let's begin. Question one. What you guys notice about this is that, so whatever they're asking you about is the underlying number, okay? So they're asking you about many times. When you look at number one, it's not even a question, it just gives you the four options of what to do with that. Do we leave it as it is? Do we change it to oftentimes, repeatedly, or do we delete it? I've got the right answers up here. Okay, I'm gonna cover those in a minute. We delete it. So here's my question, Alyssa. Why do we delete it?
Because it makes no sense. Frequently, many times.
Okay, so guys, how many words did I have to read to figure out that that's the right answer?
Three.
Two.
I had to read the one word next to it, right? Frequently. Frequently and many times. That's the same thing, right? Did I even have to read the whole sentence? No, I did not. Would it have helped? It's possible, it could have helped. But if I know that all they're asking me to do is pick which is the best choice, and I see frequently next to that, I know that that's redundant, right? Frequently means the same exact thing as many times. So I'm gonna get rid of it. So I'm gonna, in pencil underneath each of these correct answers, I'm gonna try to tell you why that's the right answer if we don't come up with it. So I'll cover the ones on the following page. This is just to let you see kind of how this is gonna work. Okay, number two.
It's on a
double. Obviously we're not changing it. Why aren't we changing it? Okay.
I literally don't know.
All right. So, Kyle.
Yes.
So glad you asked. Okay. An effect is an outcome. Okay? It's the result of something. It's a thing. So when it says, in truth, the agency has a widespread positive, we know that these are adjectives describing a thing. Okay? So we know that this needs to be a noun. If we know that that needs to be a noun, Kyle, if we know that that needs to be a noun, we can automatically cross these two off, right? So it's either going to be A or C. So then we just have to figure out, do people normally say effect on or effect to?
Effect
to.
They normally, okay. One of the things you can do with this section, the writing test, a lot of times you can just give it the ear test. Does that sound correct? Okay. Now, if you have a terribly horrific, terrible grammar ear, that will not apply to you, okay? You cannot do that. But if you have a general understanding of how English works, we know that effect to is not commonly used, and so we know we're going to leave it. So, Kyle, effect is a thing, right? Okay, it's the outcome of something. An affect, if I said, Dylan was very... His behavior was very affected because he was nervous because he was sitting so close to Alyssa Wheeler. His heart just flooded, okay? He was changed, okay? So, he was affected, okay? Affect is a verb, okay? Effect is a noun. Okay.
Here we go.
Okay. How do we do on those two? Perfect?
Great.
All right. Oh, yeah. Next section. Okay. So number three. Without reading this passage, let's look at the sentence. The sentence reads, it's a long one. In truth, the agency has a widespread positive effect on society by serving as a catalyst for innovation and scientific understanding to create jobs and showing humanity its place within the universe. So you guys select your best answer right now. Everybody shout out your answer right now.
B.
Yeah.
Oh man.
It's B. Okay, so if you said B, why is it B?
Because it makes sense. It sounds yes. better.
It's because
it sounds good.
I know.
They don't have IG.
Okay, guys, if you look at this sentence, it said serving blah 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 blah, comma, this hot mess, and then it said and showing. So you had two verbs that were serving and showing. So let's look at our options. Which one of those, and this is one of those questions where we should not take very long on this, because we know the only one that follows that verb form is B. So that should be a fast one, okay? So that's parallel structure, okay? So if I said, I like ice cream, pizza, and Kyle sober, which of those three doesn't fit? Okay, these are two things that you eat, and no, Kyle, so not him. So parallelism, or parallel structure, what that means is, does the style of each of those things that are separated with commas in a list, do they match? Okay? So that's parallel structure. That's one of the topics they're watching out for all the time in this test. Number four. Oh, crap. I'm going to get better at this, I swear.
Why is your intercom not working?
It's not supposed to
go. Cut the wire to it? Some much aggressive.
Yeah, we don't want to join the party.
So what'd you guys say about number four? Okay, so let's look at the sentence. By initiating and collaborating on projects such as the Apollo moon missions, comma, the space shuttle program, comma, the Hubble Space Telescope, comma, and unmanned planetary exploration. No change. And what it's asking us about is how do you use commas with a series? Because what it was changing is the punctuation working with the conjunction and. Okay, so there's a list of things. How do you guys feel about comma rules?
I prefer to use as many commas as I can.
So, hey Wheeler, would you hold up that packet? Yes, that one. So each of you guys, I gave you a packet. It's got some of the most important grammar rules that relate to the SAT. I also have a slide with links of places you can practice. We'll look at those at the end of this period. Okay, number five. What'd you guys say for number five?
C.
C.
Why'd you say C if you said C? Because remember, the
Y
is more important.
Because after that is when they list technology.
Very good. So it is C. And the reason it's C is you should know in the following part of that paragraph, it talks about new technologies that they introduce. So, one of the things I want you to see here is we're up to five questions. How many of them have we actually had to read the whole passage on?
Like
zero. Zero of them, okay? We had to look around the section where it's at. There are other ones we are gonna have to read. We can't answer them correctly if you don't read the whole passage. But so far, we've done pretty well, right? So time-wise, this would be a good strategy for this English section, the writing and language section. This would be a maybe not work for you on the reading section. Remember how some of you tried to do the answers without reading and you didn't like that? It works really easily on this section if you know what they're asking you for, what they're asking you to find. Okay, number six, what'd you guys say?
I said, ow, Dylan. Stab my finger with a pencil.
It is C. If you said C, why did you say C? Okay. So, number six, guys, is a word choice question. So they're asking you to think about what's the meaning of each of these words. And in that section, which word with the best meaning fits in, and the best word meaning is developed. And actually, if you think about question number five can actually help you get the right answer to question number six, sort of, right? Don't they kind of work together? So that's a word choice issue. Number seven, what'd you say?
B.
B.
Yay.
B.
Okay, why is it B? Somebody who said B.
I said C.
I said C. I said C.
Okay. Yeah, this was in the past. So if you go back, even just go back one sentence, all along these NASA projects, and again, number five can help you because look at all the verb tenses. Garnered, generated, made, those are all past tense verbs, right? So, you know it can't be spawning because that's a present tense verb. It could be has spawned, but that wouldn't match any of the other verb tenses we've been using in the paragraph, okay? So it is be, and that's a verb tense question. How you guys feel about this so far?
Easy.
All right. Now I believe. Okay, what about eight? What'd you guys say for eight?
D.
Yeah.
D. Oh, my God.
So, again, it's the same exact type of question I asked you on seven. It's a verb tense question. It's a so we know that it can't be C because if we're in Spanish, we know that that's called infinitive, right? That's the infinitive form of a verb. We're not using that form, okay? So it's D. Okay. Verb tense. Sorry, I'll try to stop drinking and actually get this on the projector here. All right, number nine, what'd you guys say?
A.
To make this paragraph most logical, okay, now here's the issue with this. What do you have to do to answer this question correctly? This is the type of question where if you're not going to read the full passage because we know it's asking us about the paragraph and how the sentences are organized in the paragraph, we probably do need to actually at least skim, if not read the whole paragraph. But we made it through eight questions without even reading the passage. Okay, so that's good. But on question nine, we do need to take some time. We have to look at the paragraph. And if we do, we put A. That's an organization question. These organization types of questions are the ones where you probably have to look at the whole, at least paragraph, if not the whole passage. Okay? How are we feeling so far? Question?
Like, how would you know that that's the best spot for it? Like, while you're reading the rest of the passage, how would you know? Compared to the other sentences.
So if we look at sentence one, a report by the Space Foundation estimated that NASA contributed $180 billion to the economy in 2005. Most of the rest of these sentences are talking about like part of that money. Here's what part of that money did. Here's what part of that money did. Or actually how it changed over time. Okay? So when we think about like when we think about paragraphs, when we think about like topic sentences for paragraphs, or if you think about a whole paper, you think about thesis, like what's my thesis statement? If you were to read all these sentences and ask yourself, because it's asking us about sentence one, what is usually the first sentence of each paragraph? It's usually a sort of like a topic sentence or like, this is what the rest of this paragraph's about. So as I'm reading through these, I could ask myself, if I know this is the question, what's the most significant sentence in this whole paragraph? And it would be that first one, okay? Because the rest of what, from two through, what's the last one? Five. Sentence two through five, those are all just explaining sentence one, okay? So you might ask, like, as you're trying to answer this question, you could ask, what's the most important sentence in the whole paragraph? It's the first one. And, or, the other thing you could do with this sort of question is you could actually plug that sentence into the other places and again, kind of do the hearing test. Does that sound like where it should go? And again, most of the time, if it doesn't sound like it's in the right spot, it's probably not in the right spot.
Okay, so...
All right, how about number 10? This point there is considering. Okay, let me tell you this. Question 10. I hate questions like number 10. Okay? Because what they're asking you to do is they're saying, get in the writer's head, act like you're writing this, and then ask yourself, if I were writing this, what would I do? And if I were writing this, I wouldn't write it this way, right? So I don't like any of the choices. So, Kyle, this is going to be one of those difficult ones that if I'm taking the test, I'm probably going to mark it, skip it, come back to it if I have more time later. Because this is going to be one that's going to take me, it's going to be a time burner. It's going to take me a lot of time. The correct answer is D. Dave, I have D.
Me.
And so what they're looking for here, and you can even see it in the answer to the question, they are looking for focus, okay? Would making this change, if I were the author, would adding this to that section, what would it do? What would it do to the essay? Okay? Now, some of these other answers could be considered good answers, right? But I have to find, what's the problem with all of these standardized tests? I have to find the best answer, the best possible answer, okay? So, a lot of times, notice how these are pretty much the exact opposite of each other. When teachers write tests, is it ever the extremes? It's not usually, okay? Because honestly, this is just like, if I'm writing this test, that's filler. Does that not look like filler? It's the same exact format. It just switches a little bit. But it either reinforces the point or it undermines the claim. It's either reinforcing or undermining. Those seem like extremes. I'm going to ignore those. Yeah, a lot of times they say it's usually never the extreme. It's usually something in between. And Kyle, honestly, when you're taking tests for other classes, don't you usually have a better shot if you pick one of the longer answers? I'm just saying. I feel that way a lot of times. That's not actually like a technical SAT strategy. That's just sometimes it works. 11. Did you guys say A?
Yeah.
Okay. What that question's all about is they're asking me about transition words. Therefore, however, actually all those options, they're all conjunctive adverbs. Okay, they're going to be asking you about these conjunctive adverbs a lot. They're transition words between sentences. And what they want to know is, what's the most correct one to put in there? Based on the sentences that are around it. So you do have to read the other sentences, okay? So because with world population topping 7 billion, humanity is in need of some perspective. Therefore, we should continue to support NASA, not only for practical. See how therefore is joining those two thoughts on each side together? Okay? There are other words like D. D would make no sense there. D is saying, however, like, that doesn't
fit. However, we should do the same thing we've been.
Yes, it doesn't fit.
Pretty much.
Okay. How are we feeling? Okay. So, the reason I wanted to do it this way is the answers are less important. What's more important is, can you understand why you got to that answer? Okay? Next page. Okay, thank you. You know me, don't you? Yeah. Okay, next passage. If you guys notice, this is the work-based passage. Remember how I said there'd be one on science, one on social studies, one on humanities, one on work, workplace? This is the workplace one. What was the last one you read? It was the science one. It was about NASA. Okay? So number 12, what do we do here?
Do you
parallelism question. Pick the one that matches the rest. So, Melissa Kistler, that's like the golden rule of this, the writing and language test. Pick the one that looks like the rest. Lots of times, what it's really looking for is, can you figure out that the sentence as it is, that doesn't make sense because it's not a good, clean series of items. New theories, practices, and technologies are transformed. Yeah. We want that parallelism. Do they all sound alike? Number 13. Well, let's read the sentence. To perform their jobs successfully in this dynamic environment, workers in many fields, from social services to manufacturing, must continually acquire relevant knowledge and update key skills. Why would I use that dash that they put in there? What's a dash show me?
Kind of enjoying them.
A dash usually shows me like an interruption in thought. Did that sound like an interruption? No, it's not an interruption. Okay. Oh, so it actually needs to be a comma. Okay? And here's why. SAT asks you guys about this topic all the time. What they're doing here is they're putting in what's called an appositive. You may remember appositives from, I don't know, middle school. And with appositives, the commas are like fences. They keep that thing separate. Or you think of them like parentheses. Okay, do we actually need this in the sentence? Could we cut it? It helps us understand, but do we need it? We don't need it. Read the sentence. Do we need it?
No.
No. So what those commas do, it's called a positive. It's like putting that phrase in parentheses. It's basically saying this is just extra information. It's also called a non-restrictive clause. Actually a phrase. Okay, so we need a comma there. Semicolon, one word, a dash really shows interruption in thought, and this is not an interruption in thought, it's just an explanation of what those fields are. Okay? Appositives are a large item on the SAT, so you need to understand. Question 13, if you don't understand that, you need to circle that. Go back and study appositives. And I actually put a page in this packet on appositives.
Do they have appositives on the reading?
Yes, they do. Number 14, what do we do there?
Stop being stupid. Is that right?
Did you guys leave it?
No, I said indeed.
That's another transition word. It's another disjunctive adverb. We need to figure out, by looking at the sentence before it and the sentence after it, what's the best transition between those two things? Okay, so after 14 questions, what percentage of questions do we actually need to read the whole passage or the whole paragraph on?
2%.
80.
I think maybe 1 or 2.
Oh,
so we need to read the whole
thing.
Yeah. Okay, it's very high that you don't need to read the whole thing. Number 15, what do you guys say about this one?
Really?
It's not A. Okay. There was a question just like this one in the previous passage. Okay? Look at, guys, look at these next sentences. If employees find themselves, words like themselves, right? Falling behind the workplace, these critics contend, then it is the duty of those employees to identify. Does it sound like the employees need to like do their own stuff? Again, I could read more of this if I was confused about what it's asking, but I think I understand just based on the key words of like, take care of yourself, that this is the point that they're going to try to make in this section. Okay. 16. If employees find themselves falling behind in the workplace, then it is the duty of those, that's another positive. We can cut it, we don't need it, and so we put a comma on each side of it. So another, a positive issue. How much time do I have for you, Ethan?
5 minutes.
All right, we'll finish this one.
Yeah.
Number 17, what's it mean if you're concise?
Oops.
Or I'm saying concision here. Word choice, concision. Concise means you use the fewest words possible. So anytime you read in the SAT writing and language section, when you read something that sounds kind of wordy, they did that on purpose. They want you to cut it down, okay? So notice that like option D on 17 is as long or longer. They don't want, if you feel like, gee, that passage they underlined sounds really like there's a lot of unnecessary words, they don't want you to make it longer, right? Brevity's the soul of wit. Okay? So, make it concise, get to the point, cut it down. And so that's what we did on 17. And finally, get old and worn out. That's a, so far as tone goes, that's a very informal way to say become obsolete. Okay, the best way to say that in a professional manner would be C, word choice of tone. What I'm gonna do, guys, let me switch over here. So I will share this presentation with you. So guys, here are some places I would go if you feel like you need to study heavily for this section of the SAT. No red ink. If you go to practice and click SAT Assist, it actually has topics that are heavily tested by SAT. If you click that tab, it shows you the most popular SAT topics, some of which you probably are already figuring out, like word choice, punctuation, positives, those are all in there. Okay. Another great place is this Grammar Bytes site. It's interactive grammar activities if you want to do them. These are all just advice from other SAT experts, and again, just you can visit Khan Academy as well. I have a Valentine's gift for you this week. This is Valentine's gift. This is the answer to this package.